Hello and welcome to today's webinar where we're exploring how CIPS brings credibility and can support development in your public sector career in procurement and supply management. We will get underway shortly. Please note this webinar is being recorded and will be available on demand after the session. I'd like to begin today's session by acknowledging the Wurundjeri Woi-wurrung people of the Eastern Kulin Nation, traditional custodians of the land on which I am joining you all to speak to you from today. And I'd like to pay my respects to their elders past, present, and future. I extend that respect to any Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders peoples who have joined us here today. A very warm welcome. The aim of this webinar is to support the building of procurement capability within the Australian and New Zealand public sector and help develop professionalisation. We're going to unpack how we've streamlined a process which will allow you to easily move from an Australian government procurement and contracting qualification so that you can progress towards achieving MCIPS, the professional certification for procurement and supply management professionals. Before we get underway, a touch of Zoom keeping. This session is being recorded and will be available to view on demand after the session. Please use the chat section to let us know who you are and where you're joining us from today. There's also a question and answer facility within your Zoom dashboard. Please use that to submit your questions throughout the session. We will certainly be putting those to our panelists and presenters towards the end of the session. So please use that to have your questions answered. My name is Charlotte Payne, and I lead an incredibly passionate and dedicated team at CIPS. We are the peak body for procurement and supply management. And what, you may ask, is the team so passionate and dedicated about? In short, it's this marvellous profession, the profession of procurement and supply management, and we take the utmost pride and care in what we do so that you guys as procurement and supply professionals can be proud of everything that you and your teams achieve. Throughout this webinar today, we're going to hear from a little bit about the Australian government qualifications and how those are recognised by CIPS as part of our advanced standing arrangements, allowing those that are studying or who have achieved the Australian government qualifications to progress towards achieving MCIPS, the professional certification for procurement and supply. We're then going to hear from Genevieve Malcolm, who's going to walk us through a bit of a case study and a worked example on what that looks like. Then we're going to be into a panel session where we will be joined by Jane Wagner, who is a member of our ACT community. Jessica Caban has kindly joined us from Procurement Services South Australia. Sarah Collins has joined us. She's over at the Australian Broadcasting Corporation. And Alyssa Hurd also joins us. She's a sourcing specialist over at New South Wales Treasury. Just a reminder, you'll have plenty of opportunity to ask your questions. Please use the Q&A facility to do so. So let's have a look at how the Australian government qualifications in procurement and contracting are recognised by CIPS so that you can actually benefit from the study and the qualification you've achieved and fast track towards achieving MCIPS. We've done a bit of work in the background, which basically means that the cert for in procurement and contracting, the diploma in procurement and contracting, and the advanced diploma in procurement and contracting, which are all Australian government qualifications, which sit on the national framework qualifications, are recognised by CIPS. And that basically means you are able to fast track your progress towards achieving MCIPS. We've got a dedicated webpage which explains in much more detail than I'm going to go on today. That's available via the QR code there if you'd like to click that using your camera on screen and check that out, and we'll drop the link into the chat towards the end of this session so that you can find out more information. So what's the point of it and how does this benefit you? First up, it actually means that you are potentially going to be very marketable as a procurement person within the Australian public sector. You'll ultimately be in line to receive effectively a dual award, one being your Australian government procurement and contracting qualification, the other being a globally recognised and transferable award from CIPS. So more bang for your buck, effectively. It also means that you can fast track to achieve your professional recognition. Not about cutting corners, it's merely about recognising learning that you have already been assessed through and have already achieved. So there's no repetition of learning there. So from a procurement perspective, it absolutely adds value. It avoids duplication and it avoids waste. It's also a very transparent way of us awarding advanced standing for the achievement that you have already been through. So what does it look like? How do these pathways work? This is a bit of a schematic just to explain a little bit about how the Australian government procurement and contracting qualifications are recognised and how ultimately you can then move towards achieving MCIPS. So starting towards the bottom left and looking at the certificate four in procurement and contracting. I know there's a number of agencies where this is a minimum requirement to be studied and achieved within the public sector if you're in a procurement role. So many of you may already be doing this qualification or thinking about starting. So CIPS recognises the Cert 4, and if you have successfully passed the Cert 4 in procurement and contracting, you're automatically eligible to pick up your CIPS studies at the CIPS Diploma in Procurement and Supply qualification. So you can basically build on the learning you've already done through the Cert 4, complement it from a global perspective, and move on up through the CIPS Diploma, the CIPS Advanced Diploma, and the CIPS Professional Diploma to achieving MCIPS. On average, that pathway would potentially take around 3 years, but that will very much depend on your personal and professional circumstances. Next up, let's just look up towards the top left-hand side of the diagram, where we're relating to the Diploma of Procurement and Contracting. So for those who are studying or who have already achieved the Diploma in Procurement and Contracting, we've done a very detailed mapping exercise of that qualification and the modules that sit within that qualification against the CIPS modules within our Diploma of Procurement and Supply. What that means is that if you've achieved that qualification, you are eligible for exemptions from some of the CIPS modules. And it potentially means that you only have to complete two modules within the CIPS diploma in order to achieve the CIPS diploma in procurement and supply, in addition to your diploma of procurement and contracting. So you would potentially get exemptions for up to six modules from within that qualification. So only having to do two is quite clearly ensuring you don't repeat learning and quite clearly then fast tracks your studies. On average, that would typically take someone between maybe 2 to 4 months to achieve those two modules. Again, that would depend on personal and professional circumstances. And I'm sure in the case study, the worked example, Jen will highlight some examples around what that might look like in terms of time frame. The next one, top right, starting point through the Advanced Diploma of Procurement and Contracting, we've done a similar exercise to map the content of that qualification against the CIPS Advanced Diploma. So again, people who have achieved the Advanced Diploma of Procurement and Contracting are eligible for exemptions from some of the CIPS modules within our Advanced Diploma qualification. All you then need to do is complete the outstanding modules and qualification and then progress towards achieving MCIPS. And again, that's potentially going to take, on average, maybe 18 months to achieve your MCIPS. The key message really, though, is continue to progress and achieve your qualification. Talk to us about where you are, and we'll absolutely help you understand what you need to do in order to achieve your CIPS recognition so that you can then progress towards achieving MCIPS, the professional certification. What does MCIPS stand for? That's very much about recognizing you as a procurement and supply professional. So it's only awarded to individuals who have attained a certain level of competency and skills, who also have relevant business experience, who commit to ethical practice, and also commit to lifelong learning. And then those people are entitled to use the designatory letters once awarded, MCIPS, Chartered Professional. To get started, join as a student. Our member services team is always happy to support and answer any questions around the student journey. Check out the dedicated webpage. We'll drop the link into the chat, but that was available through the QR code earlier in the presentation. You can then see which exemptions you can apply for. Crack on, apply for your exemptions through your MCIPS dashboard. Once you've got those exemptions, you'll be able to see which modules you then need to finish off in your CIPS qualification, and you can progress through and study those. And then you can complete your qualification and move on towards MCIPS. So that's a very brief overview of what that pathway looks like. And to perhaps provide you with a little bit more context, I'm going to invite Genevieve Malcolm, who's going to walk us through a case study on how to move from the Australian Government procurement and contracting qualifications through to MCIPS. Welcome, Genevieve.
Thanks very much, Charlotte, and thanks for giving that overview. Just so everyone knows for a bit of context of what I'll talk about, I'm just going to move through what it might look like to go through those steps that Charlotte's just been through to give you a bit of more a practical sense of what it might actually look like. Just in terms of my background, my name's Genevieve Malcolm. I'm the Director of Operations at AcademyGlobal. And just a little background on AcademyGlobal, or AG as we call ourselves. We're a leading provider of procurement and contract management training for corporate and public sector organisations throughout Australia and New Zealand. And we offer that face-to-face, virtual and online e-learning solutions. So Charlotte's talked a little bit about how the AQF and the CIPS diploma pathway works. And I might just add a little bit of context to that to help you understand, because this can often be quite an area where students have a lot of questions about how it applies to them, where they might be eligible for exemptions and what it looks like to go through that pathway. So you're probably familiar with the Australian Qualifications Framework, the AQF qualifications that Charlotte mentioned, which is a national policy for regulated qualifications in the Australian education and training environment. And it incorporates the qualifications from each education and training sector into a single comprehensive national qualification framework. And this includes the public sector training package that the AQF Diploma of Procurement and Contracting and the AQF Advanced Diploma of Procurement and Contracting fall under. So we also offer both the AQF qualifications and CIPS qualifications. So I'll talk a little bit about how they intermix and what it looks like to study both of those as well, referencing some of the diagrams that Charlotte did introduce earlier. We're also Australia's only CIPS study centre, so we also offer the CIPS qualifications, and I'm just going to talk through the pathways for study available and how it is possible to effectively fast track the path to professionalisation and also ensure you're equipped with public sector specific skills and knowledge, but you're also able to gain the vast benefits that do come from studying with CIPS and connecting to its global network and also achieving a globally recognised award. So AG has been approved as a CIPS study centre for Australia and New Zealand since 2019, and we offer CIPS qualifications through virtual tutorials led by our FCIPS and MCIPS tutors, including Sarah Collins, who'll be on the panel here with us today and speaking a little bit later. And studying with us as a CIPS study centre provides students with a blended and supported pathway to achieving CIPS qualifications. We offer these through tutor-led tutorials, enabling students to ask questions and seek feedback, exam revision, additional learning resources, and you also get some revision material in the form of e-learning modules. In our public open classes, you can also benefit from the extended network of colleagues. So if you want to go down a different path to self-studying, you can also study with us to gain access to tutors and classmates from different organisations throughout the region, which can also help you if you have studied previously in the past doing AQF and have only studied previously with people in the public sector. It can also, you know, open your mind and broaden your network to other environments and operating organizations as well. we partner with UQ Skills. So we're not a registered training organisation, but we do offer the and deliver the AQF qualifications in partnership with UQ Skills from the University of Queensland. And I'll just talk through the examples of the New South Wales and Queensland government as two examples of where students have undertaken an AQF qualification and then effectively gone on to top up with the CIPS subjects so that they've achieved both qualifications and have been able to benefit from that. So the nationally recognised program is suitable for public sector procurement and contract management staff seeking to gain skills and knowledge required to work in the public sector procurement and contract environment. If you're either looking at these qualifications or you may have previously completed them, you're probably aware that it's more targeted around some things that are quite specific to the legislation and regulatory environment of the public sector. Study plan for this usually involves facilitator-led workshops and assessment through assignments and work-based portfolios. So students are able to relate their learning back to their own public sector environment and also use examples from the workplace as some of their assessment evidence. These programs are typically ideal for individuals and organisations that are seeking to build capability and integrity into their procurement and contracting arrangements. And they feature a lot of case studies and leading industry guest speakers from CPOs across both private and public sectors. As Charlotte mentioned, there's been a lot of work done to have these nationally recognised programs also recognised by CIPS so that you don't have to, it's not an either or situation, and you're also able to benefit from advancing in the learning pathway you might have already achieved. So I think one of Charlotte's slides mentioned that you may be further along in this path than you might think. So if you have achieved a diploma of procurement and contracting under the AQF award, you might have as little as two subjects from the CIPS diploma to then complete and have your previous qualification recognised and then be able to progress on through the professionalisation pathway with CIPS. So this really helps to support those who are working in the public sector and have already completed Australian government qualifications to build on with further study and move forward in achieving CIPS recognition and professionalisation. So as part of our work with New South Wales and Queensland government, we've designed the AQF qualifications we accredit so that they do receive the maximum recognition from CIPS and include all units that you need to be eligible for that recognition. As Charlotte mentioned, there is a bit of difference between how much recognition you can get, just dependent on the electives that are selected within the AQF diploma. So CIPS does have an accreditation statement and can provide some advice on that. So you'll be able to find out exactly which subjects you need to do. So just for the example, Alyssa, who will be speaking later in the panel, is one of our previous AQF students who completed the Diploma of Procurement and Contracting under the AQF award with us, and then went on to study the final two CIPS subjects that she needed to do, and has just recently, as she'll be able to tell us in person, been successful in completing the diploma, so the final two top-up subjects she needed to complete. So she'll be able to talk through the first-hand experience, but this is the main experience of a lot of our students. So they might undertake the AQF diploma first or even concurrently, depending on their workload and appetite for study. And then at the end, they may top up with the CIPS subjects, which usually turns out to be a good path in terms of their own exposure and how they want to progress in their study as well, because they're able to benefit from some of the more public sector specific things before then looking at some more models and some more case studies introduced through CIPS, and also the extended network that they gain through CIPS as well. So really this means that when our students graduate from the AQF qualification, they walk away having completed a qualification that's nationally recognised and contains public sector specific concepts, skills and knowledge required of procurement professionals operating in this environment, and also the effective advanced standing into the CIPS professional qualifications and to move on in their path towards MCIPS. And Charlotte showed a diagram that highlights this for you. So yeah, you only need to do those two extra subjects, and then you can do the same with the advanced diploma and move forward through there as well. So this really gives you both public sector focus and global portability and recognition of your procurement, your professional procurement skills, to help you stand out as a certified practitioner. So there's a lot to gain from being able to go through this pathway, because you get to keep some of the best parts of the AQF qualifications and that public sector focus, while also being able to progress with CIPS and extend your network as well. We will hear firsthand from our students, so I'm excited to hear some of your questions to the panel of what that study pathway looks like. In terms of timeframe as well that Charlotte mentioned, it does differ a bit by student. Often it will take over a period of just over a year to complete both that AQF qualification and then your top-up subjects. Again, depending a little bit on how many exemptions are available to you. But that's just an example, and I'm sure Alyssa will be able to speak firsthand to that as well. So I might even then hand over now to our panel to answer some questions, and I'm happy to pop in as well.
Thanks very much, Charlotte and Genevieve, for that terrific introduction on how we can streamline some of the ways that we can potentially get to MCIPS. I'm going to commence the panel discussion. Please, if you have any questions, pop them into the Q&A. But I might start by asking Charlotte, which I know you've answered this in the chat, but perhaps the question is around what are the two modules that somebody who might have a diploma already has need to top up to in order to reach the next level?
Thanks, Jane. And it probably won't surprise you that that's one of our most frequently asked questions, which you'd expect from procurement professionals. So for those that hold the Diploma of Procurement and Contracting qualification, you will potentially need to complete a minimum of two CIPS modules. Those two modules are Procurement and Supply in Practice, and the Scope and Influence of Procurement and Supply. Just for context, that scope and influence of procurement and supply is really a kind of a rounding module to really introduce you into the context of procurement and supply. So it'll take what you've already studied in terms of how procurement is done in the public sector, but it will broaden it with that wider lens that may be applied, obviously in the public sector, but also thinking about what does that look like in the private sector? And to Jen's point, that's really how you can kind of start to drive innovation and best practice from different perspectives of procurement and supply management. The procurement and supply in practice module kind of does what it says on the tin. It's very much about taking everything that you've learned and applying that. So the kinds of questions will very much expect you to provide examples of how you've conducted procurement activities within your place of work. And obviously, more often than not, they'll be from your own procurement government agency or department. And that's great. And it really does consolidate your learning. And what I should probably mention is there are up to six modules that you will gain exemptions from within that CIPS diploma. So, you know, best case scenario, you'll get six module exemptions and have to complete two CIPS modules. Alternatively, if you've done a certain combination of elective modules, units within your procurement and contract, so check the accreditation statement. It's available on that dedicated webpage, and our member services team are also happy to help you. Jen's team are also happy to help you with that, just to identify which elective units from the procurement and contracting qualification you need to complete to make sure you maximize your exemptions from CIPS.
I have another question for you, Charlotte. Is there an indicative module cost, perhaps from doing it either online or Genevieve through AcademyGlobal? So I might go with you first, Charlotte.
Yeah, sure. So if you're doing your module online, you would need to join as a CIPS student. And I'm going to round the numbers because it's just a little bit easier to work to. So, you know, allow around $300 for your CIPS student membership subscription. That's a 12-month subscription, by the way. So obviously you're potentially going to study quite a lot during that time. So think of that as a one-off upfront to cover you for a 12-month subscription. You then need to purchase your learning materials. For the two modules that I've just highlighted, the ebook comes in at around $80. So $80 for scope and influence, $80 for procurement and supply in practice. You may wish to complement that with CIPS e-learning. E-learning, again, same price, around $80 for each of those. So that's potentially two times $80 per module, so $160 per module in addition to that membership upfront. Then you need to think about your exam registration fee. All of the exams are sat using a remote invigilation solution. So what that means is fantastic. You don't have to travel to an exam centre and deal with the stress of traffic. You also don't have any travel costs or time to think about. So the exam price just allow around $300 for the exam price. So all of the prices are available on the CIPS website, but I'm sure you can see how that's a very a relatively cheap way to achieve your CIPS qualification. However, be warned, obviously study to go in there as well.
Thanks, Charlotte. And I might pass to Genevieve as well, if you are able to give an indicative cost for doing the uplift.
Yeah, of course. So if you only have those two subjects, which are the L4M1 and the L4M8 to do, each of those with us work out to a total of $1,750 if you want to have the additional support of studying with the study centre. And that's just in addition to whatever you previously did. So you do get out of having to do the additional subjects, but you can learn with someone like Sarah Collins, who's on, one of our tutors who's on board today as well. So that way you can just attend tutorials to enhance your study as well and give you a little bit of networking with your classmates as well as you move through that journey.
Thank you ever so much for that, Genevieve. And that's a great segue to introduce our other panelists. So Sarah, Jessica and Alyssa. And I might start with you, Sarah, with a question. What are the benefits have been derived from professionalisation that you've seen in the public sector procurement?
Yeah, well, probably just to give context, so I obviously work at the ABC now, so we're a Commonwealth corporate entity, so basically a Commonwealth government business. I was New South Wales government prior to this, so Transport for New South Wales. So I started there it was 10 years ago in 2013, and I sort of came in, I was already in MCIPS at that stage, really excited about I guess helping to professionalise procurement within the government space. And I was actually quite surprised by how the CIPS really had barely any profile in New South Wales government at that stage. I know CIPS, the GM at that stage was trying to get an audience and was struggling. And everything was just very much focused on doing the Australian government qualifications. And I found that meant that people who were applying for roles in my team only had public sector sort of experience in procurement and public sector experience in education and learning about procurement. So as I started seeing it evolving with going out to the recruitment market for people who hadn't necessarily had government experience or had dipped in and out, I sort of saw once we sort of had people coming in and had experience with MCIPS or learning through bespoke programs that other organisations were doing, that brought a real mix of thought into sort of the government. And so by the time I left the New South Wales government, I really saw that really changing. The CIPS were now recognising the diploma level from the Australian government quals, and we were seeing people who were starting to get that real mix between sort of learning from both sides. And I guess probably answering your question there, Jane, is it's about having people who have a broader context to procurement. It doesn't matter what sector they're working in, because then you really understand the merits of what it means to work in different environments and what it means when you've got different rules and regulations and governance around you, because whether you're spending public money, private money, et cetera. And, you know, even if you're working in government, you get it from the other side. So I guess to answer the question, I'm looking for people who've got well-rounded experience or at least educational experience on all sectors and all types of procurement in terms of when I'm employing people, because I feel that brings sort of a richness to what they're doing and how it brings leading practice thinking into my organisation.
Yeah, fantastic. Thanks very much for that, Sarah. I might ask the same question of Jessica. What have been the benefits being derived from professionalisation, particularly in South Australian procurement?
Hi, thank you so much for having me today. So we started out capability uplift journey back in 2021 with the launch of a new capability development strategy for South Australian government. And it was the first time that we invested a separate budget for capability development across the South Australian public sector. And that allowed us to come at that from a very from multiple different ways, in terms of those just very much starting out in their procurement career, to also supporting and recognising those who had had a significant procurement and contract management career, whether it be in the public sector or coming across into government from the private sector. So for us, our goal is to highlight the importance of the procurement function within the South Australian government, and for us to be able to demonstrate how it can achieve fantastic outcomes for our state. So in order to do that, we launched straight into our capability development strategy to recognise the importance and the professionalisation of the sector within South Australian government, and to also recognise that it was its own standalone profession with standalone, you know, skill sets and knowledge and experience that needs to be recognised. One of the ways in which we've done that is through the achievement and obtaining MCIPS for our chief procurement officers across government. And we launched into a targeted program of support to those chief procurement officers who hadn't yet achieved their MCIPS to do so through either the CIPS corporate award program to achieve through their advanced diploma and then on to MCIPS, as well as through the MCIPS managerial experience pathway as well. That has been successful for a number of reasons. And perhaps, Jane, if I could speak to Teresa's question that I can see in the chat, in terms of the benefits that we have seen from that experiential pathway, which is something we've helped almost 12 chief procurement officers to achieve in the last 12 months, use that pathway to achieve their MCIPS. We've seen, Teresa, we've seen this as a real opportunity for us to recognise these professionals within the South Australian government by having recognition from their peers and from the global peak body that they have these this knowledge, skills and experience that sets them apart as advanced professionals is really important for that personal recognition after many years of doing the hard work. In a practical sense. It also was a retention strategy for us in terms of we provided the financial support for these chief procurement officers to obtain their MCIPS. And it was, there's not much, as those of us who are in government know, there's not too much you can do in government to entice and award people to stay in the public sector when the private sector is looking over the fence to poach them. So as a retention strategy, you know, we did fund our chief procurement officers to complete their MCIPS through the managerial experiential pathway. And that was a great recognition for them as well, in terms of from a retention, that we were looking to invest in not only those up and coming, but those who were the leaders and the strategic decision makers of procurement and government. It has also raised the bar for us in terms of what is a minimum requirement for a chief procurement officer in the South Australian government. And prior to this, it was actually rare to see an MCIPS as an essential requirement in job and person specs. It's now becoming an essential requirement. And so that means for an indirect benefit is that those looking up to wanting to see in their horizon the career pathway to a chief procurement officer role, they now see that that is a requirement. And so we're seeing that second tier of managers now invest in their own capability and looking to achieve MCIPS themselves so that they're ready to take on that next opportunity as a chief procurement officer when those jobs become available, because it's now resetting that benchmark of the minimum standard. And it's always, of course, that influence that it has on others to enter into procurement as a profession, to see that it is recognised globally. And that support that has been recognised by our graduate program, which is our entry level. They can now see that they can leave university with a like or relevant degree and then see for themselves that they can advance all the way up to a profession that's globally recognised. And so for us, it makes a job in procurement even more attractive and easier for us to promote to those procurement graduates. So hopefully, Teresa, right, I've helped to answer your question at the same time as Jane's.
Fantastic. Thanks ever so much, Jessica. That's great. I might bring Elisa into the discussion at the moment and ask you, what have been the benefits for you as a student doing your diploma and as you move on your pathway to MCIPS?
I think I'd like to start by saying there's been a lot of talk about fast tracking, which is fantastic. But in my individual circumstance, I needed flexibility. I have a very young family. My youngest son is 2. So the fact that there's that flexibility in how you and the time frame to complete the modules really worked for me. And then knowing that I had the support of AcademyGlobal and CIPS, and that there was that my individual situation would be tailored to. So I completed the Diploma of Procurement and Contracting back in 2020, and then only just completed the last module to achieve my CIPS diploma very recently. So that's been one of the main benefits. And I think Charlotte spoke to that broadening that perspective. So I think I didn't realise how interlinked procurement was, that it was, there were so many concepts that apply to whatever sector you work in, because I've only ever had a job in procurement as a government sector employee. So I guess just understanding that the concepts are the same, whether you're talking about private, local government, private, any sort of sector, there are concepts that overlap. So there's that. And then I think the last benefit is just that broadening of my network. That's been hugely valuable for my journey.
Great. Thanks very much, Elisa. We've got a couple of questions coming through in the question and answer part of the Zoom. And I might refer these back to Charlotte. The question is it only the Cert 4 and diploma that are recognised as prior learning, or are there other avenues of entering into CIPS or gaining MCIPS, such as through a Bachelor of Commerce, Finance, Business Economics, or with a Master's in Logistics and Supply Chain Management?
Okay, how do I simplify this one? I guess the short answer is yes, there are a range of ways to have any study you've already achieved, any qualifications that you've already been awarded, recognised by CIPS, provided they match our requirements and standards. So the short answer is yes. It's probably best to pick up any individual circumstances by talking to our member services team. What I would say is that we do have a range of degree programmes that we accredit directly to MCIPS. Those programmes are all listed on our website so that you can actually see when you're looking from, thinking about what to study and which university with and which programme, check out what's recognised by CIPS, contact the university directly to find out more information. So that's available on our website. Equally, speak to our member services team. I'll follow up and pop those contact details in the chat for you. For those interested in studying CIPS professional qualifications, so that's the CIPS diploma, advanced diploma, and professional diploma, and if you've already achieved a degree in the past 5 years, we do have a standalone exemptions policy, which means that if you've actually covered learning that we already have in our qualifications in your degree, you can actually apply for exemptions for those. So say you've done a negotiation module within your degree, you could apply to CIPS for an exemption from our negotiation module, provided the learning and the content matches. So again, the exemptions policy is available on our website. If you've got any questions, reach out to our member services team.
Thanks, Charlotte. And also staying with you, I have another question in the Q&A around, I guess, somebody who is joining us today from not from the public sector, even though this session is around the public sector, but public sector procurement officials obviously have a lot of people in the private sector that also work to government, and often they have to understand our own procurement framework. But if somebody had, say, about 8 years experience, the question is around where would they start with, I guess, their qualifications, supplementing where they haven't had qualifications before. What would their pathway look like? And also whether they were able to transition from the private sector to the public sector with these sorts of qualifications.
All right. So there's potentially quite a broad answer. And again, I'd probably invite that person after this session, have a consultation with one of our member services just to look at your specific circumstances, and then we could give you some specific advice. But based on that information, there's a number of options. So number one, if you've got at least 5 years managerial level experience in procurement and supply, there is no need for you to directly study qualifications unless you want to acquire any new learning. You may be eligible to apply for MCIPS via our experiential pathway, which actually Jess referred to in her piece. That's not a qualification, it doesn't involve study. What it does do is recognize learning that you've already done and competencies, capabilities that you've already developed throughout your career, through your job, through your experience and your career history. It does involve an independent assessment, but definitely consider that one if you have at least 5 years managerial level experience in procurement and supply. If that doesn't apply to you, and you're looking to transition from the private sector to the public sector, absolutely consider the procurement and contracting Australian government qualifications. I would suggest with that level of experience, the CIRP 4 is probably too low level for you. You may wish to consider the Diploma of Procurement and Contracting, or equally the Advanced Diploma of Procurement and Contracting. And organisations like AcademyGlobal would be able to advise you based on your experience, which entry point you'd be best suited to start, and whether you can actually start at the Advanced Diploma of Procurement and Contracting. There's nothing to stop you studying the CIPS professional qualifications in parallel, but again, I'd probably work through what does that look like with a member of a member services team or an organisation like AcademyGlobal, just to kind of factor in personal and professional circumstances.
Great, thanks, Charlotte. I might bring the other panel members back in, and I might go to Sarah first. Sarah, you've got such a wide range of experiences in New South Wales government and Commonwealth government, but how have you gone about building procurement capability within your organisations that you've worked for?
Yeah, so prior to that, I was actually university as well, and we did work with the APCC then with regards to their framework as well. This is over 10 years ago, but aligning our jobs to the qualification levels, the job capability levels that they had in place back then. So that was really, really helpful, having that external benchmark for us to understand what we needed and where we went with our learning and development. But certainly with regards to sort of my more recent career, where I am at the moment, I have been through sort of a process of, I guess, transforming procurement. And one of the things I've really been focusing on is bringing in people who are procurement professionals. I'm not saying that other people who work for me weren't procurement professionals, but in a lot of cases, some of them had transferred in sideways from other roles. And I found that there wasn't sort of that leading practice thinking. So this is a case in point. I only started at the ABC in the very end of 2018, but I introduced the concept of a procurement strategy. And you would think I'd invented the concept of a procurement strategy. People were so receptive to it. And I'm thinking, this is just one of our stock standard tools. I didn't invent this, but no one here had ever heard of one. So it's just bringing in some of that good practice, you know, bringing in the category management, the supplier relationship management, ESG before it was actually called ESG, all these sort of things that we have as the experience from other organisations, when people have just been sort of shifting from job to job within their own organisation, they haven't necessarily had that experience outside. So doing things like your professional qualifications, this is where you start getting that exposure. So I'm not saying that you have to have come from the outside, but you've focused on saying, okay, I'm now actually a procurement professional. I'm going to learn what it means to be that rather than just learning on the job. I'm not saying learning on the job doesn't have its merits, but I think especially in what we do, I don't think we can fully just learn on our job because we just learn from the previous practices. We're not learning what other organisations are doing. But then on the flip side of it, I've had someone who just started in my team last week, my most recent hire. He's a couple of years into procurement. He is a classic case of he was an engineer, got a little bit of a taste of procurement and realised this is a much better profession. And also realised I want to study. So he's doing his MCIPS, he's doing his level 3 at the moment. But he was doing his studying in Charlotte. I don't know what subjects he was doing. He had two exams last week. But he suddenly got all this exposure to public sector procurement. And he's like, I'm not seeing any of this in the role I've got. So he went looking for a new job in the public sector. I know I'll probably only have him for a few years. That's fine. You know, for me, I've got someone who's doing their studying and who is really eager to learn and apply that. And the fact that he's actually changed roles and changed sectors to be able to start applying some of his learnings, I think is really admirable. So that's sort of some examples of within my own sort of experience. But it has been a bit of a slog because you feel like you've just started to make progress and then you get people coming in sideways. They think they know how to do our job and you're constantly battling and constantly arguing that we're a proper profession. You know, we are real. We're a real profession just like accounting is or being a lawyer is, et cetera. So I just find that there is still that constant people are being brought in sideways at the senior levels. And then you sort of feel like you're starting from scratch again as someone who's got very long-term procurement experience, explaining the basics to people who are at quite senior levels, and that can get quite exhausting as well. But yeah, that's sort of in a snapshot. I hope I answered your question. I feel I went around on a tangent there, but to me, it's that constant challenge of getting the fresh thinking, but it's also it's the upward questions about whether we are actually a real profession, how are we adding value, all of that sort of stuff. And it's a constant battle I think a lot of us have.
Yeah, I can completely agree with that assessment, Sarah. I might bring Jessica back in to ask a similar question. Some of this you covered a little bit more, but you might like to, in your earlier response, but maybe you might like to cover off on the same thing around how the South Australian government has gone about building procurement capability within your jurisdiction.
So through our capability development strategy, it's been a sort of multi-pronged attack approach, but key to it is accessibility. What we found prior to 2021, which is when sort of procurement was refreshed within government in terms of moving from a formal board arrangement to us being a branch of Department of Treasury and Finance, was that it was that very traditional training calendar of face-to-face courses that might, you know, become available every 6 months or so, and it's a day or two out of the office. And, you know, is expensive from, you know, from a cost and time, you know, and resources, and mostly centralised in Adelaide, which meant that our procurement contract managers in regional areas, there was a lot of barriers to access. So one of the things that we set about doing was improving the accessibility of our suite of capability development programs. And, you know, we have now, we still have those face-to-face courses. Some people can't move past tradition. They do enjoy getting out of the workplace and sitting in a classroom environment. We do have those. We also have invested heavily in webinars with various subject matter experts on various topics and new and emerging trends in procurement, which we've found to be highly successful, especially with their 90 minutes remote access via MS Teams and provided free of charge. So we're finding that there's hundreds of people attending our webinars compared to 20 people in a classroom. So the accessibility there is growing with each class we run. The focus on professional qualifications, we put 20 people through a Cert 4. At the moment, we're putting 20 people through a diploma. And we've put people through the corporate award program with CIPS, and then the experiential pathway for MCIPS as well. We also have professional memberships in terms of with CIPS, also with other bodies as well. And that increases their exposure to other procurement professionals, not just within government, but within the state and nationally, which has been fantastic. We're seeing much more uptake in them attending CIPS networking events that are being held by the SA chapter. And we also created a mentoring program. So we now have 100 people across South Australian government, a junior procurement professional being mentored by a senior procurement professional. That's 12 months in now. And that professional mentoring relationship has been great in terms of not only knowledge sharing and career and professional support, but as you know, working within government, it's great to know who's who in the zoo and who's working on different projects. And that collaboration has increased through our membership across agencies, has increased through our mentoring program as well. Throughout most of this, this is all funded centrally by Procurement Services SA. I cannot lie, that's a significant success factor for us to reduce that cost to our agencies. But where they haven't, we've not had the opportunity to fully fund, we might part fund or subsidise their participation. So we're fortunate to have a committed budget by the South Australian Government for professional development of procurement and contract managers, and looking to improve on that over time. One thing that I did forget to mention is that we created a learning management system with e-learning modules as well that are accessible on demand, and through CIPS undertook not only the skills gap analysis but then also the digital academy as well, so that those who could identify their skills gaps could then undertake capability development training and utilising those e-learning resources that were mapped from their skills gap analysis to the CIPS digital academy. So it's been a hive of activity, lots of different activities happening, but together we've found that it's reached not only those more the professions and the advanced professionals, but those who have procurement, who are just starting out in procurement or have procurement as a small part of their role in government rather than their primary job.
That's a really considerable uplift that the South Australian government has invested in their procurement and contract management professionals. Unseen, I think, across Australia, to be perfectly honest, other than perhaps in Queensland. So credit to the team over in South Australia for their efforts to professionalise procurement and contract management professionals. I might bring Alisa back into the conversation. Do you have any tips for students who might be on their journey? They might be either studying through the CIPS medium or potentially through an organisation such as AcademyGlobal that you can share from your experience.
I think it's been touched on already, but definitely have those conversations about your individual scenario. The team at AcademyGlobal and CIPS are very helpful in that way. I found that that's been instrumental to my pathway. The other thing I'd say is have the conversations with your agency about the value that this brings for the agency as a whole, for government sector as a whole. That capability uplift, that professionalisation of procurement, because to an earlier point as well, there's still that stigma attached to procurement not being a real function, that it's just, that we just buy stuff. There's still that kind of, we're still fighting that battle. I think this is really important, and it's really important that government understands how this will benefit the sector. So that starts with conversations with your manager that will go up through the levels of leadership. But I certainly, I had that conversation to get this funded, the diploma, and had to paint the picture and put my proposal forward. And I think it's recognised that was a really good investment for my agency anyway.
I think that's really important, Elisa, and one of the reasons why we, the ACT committee, wanted to do this particular webinar at this time of the year is that we're all either ending off our year with performance discussions about how we've gone over the past year and starting to think about, well, what do we want to do? What skills do we want to develop in our next performance discussion? And this feeds really nicely into that. And I think the other thing that you just mentioned was around, I guess, procurement as a profession. And I guess my own experience where on 24 hours notice back in 2021, at the height of the COVID pandemic, the task force, the COVID task force, reached out to the Department of Finance, where I was currently working, and said, help, we need procurement and contract management expertise, who can you send? And 2 years later, I'm still in the Department of Health helping with a range of procurement and contract management issues. And as part of my role and my legacy, if I ever leave from this role, was ensuring that at least 16 people in the Department of Health undertook a diploma of procurement and contracting, to ensure that that legacy meant that when I leave, there'll be people who can certainly do those tasks, but have the qualifications behind them as well. So it was really important in terms of building capability in a different environment. What I might do is there's just one question outstanding, which is in the chat, and it's around when the Australian qualification framework recognised the certificate for the diploma and the advanced diploma. I don't really know the answer to that question, but it's probably at least 15, 20 years ago. So it's always been part of the Australian qualification framework, at least while I've been in procurement. I think what I might do now is just thank our presenters, Charlotte and Genevieve, for the terrific introduction to this topic. Like Charlotte mentioned, there is information on the website, and I know that she's put a link into the chat for people to go and explore on their own after this webinar. I'd also really like to thank our panellists, Jessica from South Australia Procurement, Sarah from the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, and Elisa Heard from New South Wales Treasury, for being so generous with your time, but also sharing your experiences. This session will be available afterwards. I'm sure the team at CIPS will send out the link for you. And I'd just really like to thank everybody for joining us today, and wish you well on your journey to MCIPS. Thanks very much, everybody.